Yes, there is a tradition of what the Sufis call the awliyâ, the friends of God. And these are spiritual beings who look after the spiritual well-being of the world, as actually a early Sufi, Al-Hakim al-Tirmidhi, he was one of the first Sufis to write about this. And he said, really, the crops cannot grow, the seasons cannot flourish without the presence in both invisible and the visible worlds of these spiritual masters. It is a esoteric secret, really, that until recently hasn't been made known, that there are these spiritual beings who look after the well-being of the world. And in the Sufi tradition, there is on earth the pole, the Qutb, who is the central figure in this world of those spiritual masters. And they are with us, they are helping us, mostly unseen, mostly unknown. Was there a time when they were known? Well, in the 12th, 13th, 14th, 15th century, there were the Qajigan, the masters of wisdom in the Middle East, in Baghdad and then in Bukhara, who were known. Whether it was known at the time that they were such great masters or not, is we don't have a record, but they were known as the Qajigan, as the masters of wisdom, and they were known as great spiritual beings, very powerful spiritual beings. And often at that time, the rulers of the land, the temporal rulers of the land, would go to them and ask them for their help and their support. And then by about the 16th century, they became hidden. They became unknown and vanished from sight. So there is, in this part of our recorded history, they were more visible at this time in the Middle East, yes. Yes, this is the golden chain of transmission, you see, it is, which traditionally starts with the Prophet, peace be upon him, and it is really a succession, or it is a transmission of spiritual grace, of spiritual power, of spiritual energy that is given from teacher to teacher to teacher, down from the beginning of time. And what the Naqshbandis would say, without that transmission, there can be really no spiritual evolution. It is an energy that is needed to help the wayfarer, the one who is drawn to the mysteries of the path, to evolve, to change, to be taken out of the world of duality, out of this world of multiplicity, back to the primal oneness that exists within the heart, and back deeper and deeper and deeper within the human being until they achieve union with God. And that is really the cornerstone of the path, is this transmission, is this energy that is passed down. And it, the golden chain is both a historical phenomenon, because it goes back from teacher to teacher to teacher, say starting with the Prophet, peace be upon him, and the transmission in the Naqshbandi lineage that was given to Abu Bakr in the cave. And so then it is passed down historically. For example, some of the great Sufis, Yusuf Hamadani and Abdul Khaliq Hujwani, who gave us the principles of the path, and then of course Bahauddin Naqshband, and further and further and further until in our particular lineage, my Sheikh Radumahun Lal, whom he called Baisab, carried this transmission, and then it was passed down through Irina Tweedy, and then I was given it. And yet it is also present in each moment of time, going directly back to the source, because in this tradition, when a spiritual master leaves his physical body, he is still present in the world of spirit, and there is still a direct connection in the inner worlds to these spiritual masters who function in the inner worlds once they have left behind this physical world, once they have passed over. And so this golden chain is directly present as a living succession from master to master to master in the inner worlds coming into this physical world. So it is both historical and atemporal. Was it present before Muhammad? Yes, many Sufis would say, of course, that it began with the Prophet. And there are other Sufis, for example, my Sheikh, who said Sufism is older than Islam, and the friends of God have always been with us, have always been guiding humanity, and that it really stretches right back to the beginning, whatever the beginning is, that it has to do with the spiritual evolution of the world and these masters who have been looking out over the evolution of the world as well as the evolution of humanity. And for example, there is a tradition that Plato was the pole of his time, was the Qutb. I don't know that for sure, it is just a tradition. So yes, the masters have always been here, present in this world, since the dawn of human consciousness, really, helping the world to evolve, helping those who are drawn to participate directly with their wisdom, their love, their power. And so interestingly, it is something that has been known of in the East, in India, but quite hidden in the West. And it has been the whole notion of spiritual power that belongs to these masters has been very carefully hidden in the West. If it was ever part of Western consciousness, I don't know. I think it is very difficult for the West to accept mystical consciousness because it is completely at variance with rational consciousness upon which Western civilization maybe not was built originally, but has evolved, particularly since the Age of Enlightenment. And say at that time the Catholic Church repressed many, many of the mystics. And so, you know, as Attar says, when love comes, reason disappears. Reason cannot live with the folly of love. And mystical consciousness is completely at variance on its own with rational consciousness, with its consciousness of the mind that dominates our contemporary life. And to take it even further, because as far as I can understand, this split came in the Catholic Church when they chose temporal power over spiritual power. And they persecuted the Gnostics, and then finally the Inquisition was born to drive out and exterminate the Cathars and other people drawn to inner wisdom or inner power. And so this dominance of temporal power over spiritual power has created a civilization that is based on worldly power, which is so conditioned us that we think it is the only way a society can be. Interestingly, recently they discovered in Cambodia, in Angkor Wat, that it was a spiritual city the size of Los Angeles, which is something we can hardly imagine. Imagine Los Angeles as being a city made of temples and pagodas and being a spiritually, being a city of spiritual practice, of spiritual foundation. And so there were civilizations before us, many, many civilizations that were grounded on a spiritual principles, on spiritual power. But as I say, that has been so much lost to our Western rational consciousness, with its focus on political power, on economic power, on military power, that we cannot even imagine what spiritual power really is. And so it would be, also the whole structures of our civilization are at variance with a spiritual dimension. They include a religious aspect often, but not a spiritual foundation, which is that we are really here in service to God. Well, there was a time in which the inner and the outer were together. There was no suggestion of the inner or the outer. It was the crops grew with spiritual blessing. You baked your bread with a prayer. Every child was born and went through certain initiations as they grew older, and becoming part of the community was a spiritual initiation. And the people who led the community were the spiritual elders. You still see that in Native American, where it was the shaman was a guiding force behind the tribe. And it is only recently that we have had this split, and this is part of the age of reason, this split between spirit and matter, between outer and inner, that has given us the fruits of science, the fruits of materialism, has sent rockets to the moon, but has caused an immense poverty in that we live in a world that we have consciously divorced from spirit. Of course, nothing can really be divorced from spirit, because the mystic knows that the spirit is the foundation of everything, just as the alchemists say there is this light hidden in matter, or the mystic sees the name of God written in every cell of creation. And so we are actually living in a state of consciousness completely at variance with what is real, with what is present, because, say, as the mystic knows, everything is made according to the will of God, and everything is made with the substance of love. But the consciousness we have inherited and the education system we have has denied that. So we build these sandcastles, not knowing the tide is going to come in. And maybe there will be a shift, maybe there will be a return to a more, in a way, reasonable way of life that honors the spirit that is within everything, and that is a way of life that we live in harmony with the world around us, rather than imposing this rational consciousness, which I say has, in a short space of time, produced this extraordinary flowering of science and materialism, but at the cost of the soul. And at the cost of a deep, deep wound that humanity carries, this lack of direct connection to the soul, lack of honoring what is sacred within ourselves and within life and within our neighbor, and how we will reclaim that way of life, which is the only sustainable way, just as ecology has shown us, we have to live in a state of ecological oneness in order to ecologically survive. I would take it even further. We have to live in a state of spiritual oneness in order that our souls survive. But how we are going to make that shift from this very, very divisive world, whose, say, consciousness has become this very, very repressive force, is really going to be the landmark of the next, some people say 20 years or 100 years, because we can no longer sustain ourselves as we are at the present moment. But it will be a difficult time of transition, because it is such a fundamental shift away from the ego, away from greed, away from the focus on worldly power, to honoring something which is both much more present, actually, and yet more spiritual. Well, there is, in the tradition of alchemy and Sufism, there is this elder spiritual figure, Dun Nun, who was one of the great early Sufis, and he is known as the alchemist. And there has been this hidden thread within Sufism, which, if you like, you can call it the alchemy of the heart, the alchemy of love, because alchemy takes as its model turning base metal or lead into gold. And what the Sufis would say is you take the base metal of the human being, the prima materia of our ordinary consciousness and the nafs, and you turn it into the gold of pure love. The human being is transformed. This is one of the greatest mysteries in in this world, the transformation of the human being, the transformation from what one would call ordinary everyday consciousness into spiritual consciousness. And this is an alchemical process. And in fact, this, in the last century, the psychologist Carl Jung made a great contribution when he rediscovered the wisdom of alchemy that had been hidden and reinterpreted it into the language of psychology, the language of psychological transformation, and really gave us back this Western heritage of inner transformation that the church had repressed and that had been hidden in alchemy. And then one, say, Jung really focused on the inner psychological transformation, what he called individuation, and how that is reflected in the alchemical language and the alchemical symbols and the whole process of, for example, discovering the pearl of great price, which is an alchemical image as well as a Sufi image. And then one can take it further because the alchemists talk about the light hidden in matter, which is not just the prima materia of the human being, but the prima materia of the earth, and the ancient spiritual teaching that is allied with that, that says physical matter itself contains an energy, contains a light, and is alive in a way we don't understand. And the alchemists say, kept this secret alive for us, because one of the mysteries of human civilization is how spiritual truths that arise in certain times are lost. For example, sacred geometry, we have lost the real understanding of sacred geometry that in the Middle Ages was part of the spiritual culture of the time in their cathedrals or in the beautiful mosques in the Middle East. And some esoteric wisdom, some spiritual knowledge is preserved, and part of the alchemical heritage we have in the West is, say, understanding both of the inner transformation of the human being, but also pointing further to the transformation of matter itself, which is, some people would say, is the realization of nuclear energy that can be released in the atomic world, but others would say deeper, that there is this spiritual light in the material world, in the substance of matter, that has the possibility to become ignited, to become alive, and that would create a very, very different relationship to the physical world and to life itself. But that is a science that has not yet evolved. That is, there is this tradition that Fulcanelli, the great alchemist, one of the few great alchemists to survive into the 20th century, asked people not to explore atomic science because in his alchemical studies he had touched upon the tremendous power and energy and its destructive potential, yes, but of course his wisdom was ignored, or it was time for human beings to be given access to that secret of matter. One doesn't know. There is a lovely story, yes, because our Sheikh, he said, Sufism is older than Islam. Under Islam, it developed its name, and of course all the tariqas and traditions that developed under Islam. But there is this story of the camel posh, the blanket wearers, and they were deeply, deeply spiritual men and women, and they were called the blanket wearers because their only possession was one blanket, which they wore about them as a covering during the day and used as a blanket at night. And the story goes that they went from prophet to prophet, looking, seeking, and they say they even went to Christ, and they never found the answer they were looking for. And according to this tradition, there was one day when the prophet, peace be upon him, was with his companions, and he said, in so many days, so many of these, the camel posh are coming. And lo and behold, in that time they arrived. And he didn't say anything to them. And they were completely satisfied and they stayed with him. And from them, the esoteric branch of Islam, Sufism, developed. And why were they completely satisfied? Because he created love in their hearts. And if you create love in somebody's heart, they are completely fulfilled as human beings. They want nothing more, except more love, of course. And so from that meeting, this hidden esoteric aspect grew, flourished, until it went all over the Middle East, to India, to Indonesia, and then in the last century came to the West and to America. You see, the love that we know is usually based upon duality. I love you. And into that relationship, as psychology has shown, there are many projections and all the psychological dynamics that arise from those projections. This is a different love. I always quote this poem of Rumi when he says, different degrees of domination and servitude are what you know as love. But love is different. It arrives complete just there, like the moon at the window. Seek only that of which you have no hope. Desire only that of which you have no clue. This is not the Oxus River or some little sea. This is the shoreless sea. Here swimming ends always in drowning. And this is this other dimension of love, which is a love based upon oneness. And in fact, the Sufis say not one, you don't need an ocean, you just need one sip of this love. They call it the wine of divine love, and you are intoxicated, you are lost forever, you just want one more sip, because it is so potent, it is so powerful. It is, our Sheikh, he said, love is the greatest force in the universe, and it is unbelievably beautiful. And yes, it creates burning in the heart, it creates desire, it creates longing for God, and it also creates tremendous states of intimacy, of nearness, of a love that fills every cell of your body until you are saturated in love, and takes you really from the world of duality, from the world of you and me, across the infinite ocean to the further shores of love, which is a place of oneness in which I am he whom I love is me. And that is one of the great esoteric secrets of the Sufis, how to use love to transform a human being, how to take them from the world of duality into the ocean of oneness, into the intimacies of the heart. Yes, this unveiling of secrets, because the Sufis describe, or they talk about these veils of separation, which is really the what separates us from our true nature, what separates us from God. It is one of the greatest paradoxes, of course, is because we are never separate from God. He is, it said in the Quran, he is nearer to you than your jugular vein. Or he's nearer to you than yourself to yourself. He is so close to you, he is part of you. And yet, in this world of appearances, we are veiled from that awareness, from that reality. And we are veiled, one might say, by the ego, or by the nafs, by the lower self, by our desires, by our ambitions, by our conditioning, and by all the images of the world around us. And so the Sufi journey is a slow process of unveiling. And why is it slow? Because if those veils were taken up too quickly, it is said the glory of his face would burn you away. Because his light, the light of divine love, the light of pure consciousness, the light of God is so powerful, is so brilliant, it is like the sun compared to a candle, compared to the light of the ego, the light of the mind. And so these veils are lifted gradually. Gradually you begin to see beyond the ego, beyond your desires, beyond your conditioning, beyond your background, beyond all of those images, and slowly you come closer and closer and closer, until the Sufis use the image of the moth being drawn to the flame, until one day you just dissolve in the light, and then there is no more separation, there is no more you and God. Then, like Bayezid Bastami said, under this cloak there is only God, which is a mystical truth, but to realize it takes training, takes time, takes practices, takes what we call the spiritual path. That's what they say. Yes, Rumi said, without a teacher I tried 100 times and failed. Because It is an impossible journey to go from the world of duality to the world of oneness, to go from the ego to the self. And it is a journey with many, many pitfalls. For example, there are so many illusions that you can get caught in. You can create your own image of what you think spiritual life is and live in it, and you need a teacher to say, no, that is just an illusion you have created. That is, this is where the path is, this is where the truth is. And also to help you with the energies that are awakened in the human being, because once you begin the spiritual journey, you begin to awaken these very powerful energies. For example, in India they have this term, the kundalini energy, which is very the dragon energy, serpent energy within you, which is a very, very powerful energy. And other energies within the heart get awakened, and you need a guide to help you. Otherwise, you can get lost. You can get lost in the maze of your own psyche, the maze of your own self, in all the pitfalls of the ego, or you can get overwhelmed by these powerful forces that erupt from the unconscious that psychology has given us some glimpse of, all these spiritual energies that can create a lot of illusions. So yes, you need a teacher. You cannot make this journey without a teacher. Yes, you can do the preparation, you can do the inner work. In fact, talking about Jung's process of individuation, Yolanda Jacobi said, individuation takes you to the entrance to the house of God. So you can do much work of preparation, but there comes a time when you need a teacher, and then the real journey can begin. You have to have total submission in front of the teacher. I wish it was that easy. Yes, you have to. Well, finally, yes. Finally, in order to go completely, to leave the world of the ego behind, yes, there has to be complete surrender or submission, depending on how you see it. You have to become, the Sufis say, less than the dust at the feet of the teacher. And this really has to do with what is called fana fil sheikh, which is merging into the teacher. And fana fil sheikh, which leads eventually to fana fil Allah, which is merging in God. Because you are really taken by love. This is a Sufi mystery. You are taken by love beyond yourself. And you have to say yes to this love. And in the tradition, this love is embodied by the teacher, by the sheikh. And so you have to say yes to the teacher. You don't actually say yes to the outer person of the teacher. You say yes to the core of love within the teacher. You say yes to the imprint of the beloved within the teacher. Or one could say yes. You say yes to the emptiness within the teacher, because the teacher is one who has been made empty. And there is a lovely saying of the founder of our order, Bahauddin Naqshband, when talking about this earlier Sufi, Al-Hakim At-Tirmidhi, he said, for 22 years I have been following in the footsteps of Al-Hakim At-Tirmidhi. He was featureless and formless, now I am featureless and formless. Those who know will know, those who understand will understand. Because in order to be a real teacher, you have to be completely empty, you have to be completely featureless and formless, just nothing, just a space for the divine. And so really the real submission, the real surrender is to that emptiness within the teacher. But the mind, of course, at the beginning cannot grasp that emptiness. It is only used to a world of forms, to a world of images. So it takes hold of the image of surrendering to the teacher. And of course, in the West, and this has created enormous misunderstanding and enormous problems, and many people feel they have been let down or betrayed because maybe they didn't understand this completely and the personality got hold of it. But it is, you surrender to the essence of the teacher. You surrender to that light within the teacher that, if it is a real teacher, is one with the light of God. But it is embodied in front of you, because for most people, a direct to surrender to God is too difficult, because God is too much of an abstract idea rather than a living reality. What is the difference between mysticism and spirituality? It's a deep question. And what is Sufism? Wow, all those together. They say that mysticism is the via negativa. One becomes less and less and less until finally, as in the words of the Christian mystic John Ruysbroeck, one is drawn into the dark silence in which all lovers lose themselves. You become less and less and less. It is as simple as that. You can say you are being drowned in love, or you lose yourself. These are just words, these are just suggestions, but say the Sufi says you have to become less than the dust at the feet of the teacher. And you know nothing, you are nothing, you become just emptiness, finally, destroyed by love. Sufis call it fana, annihilated by love, lost in love, lost in the company of those who are lost in God. That is mysticism, spirituality. There is, you see, human beings have certain spiritual energies and spiritual bodies. It's too big a subject to go into now, but you can evolve spiritually, you can become a more spiritual person, you can gain spiritual qualities, you can become clairvoyant, you can begin to access your spiritual nature, you can begin to live in the light of your spiritual self, you can be guided by your higher self. There are many, many ways to evolve spiritually. Or, for example, you can make a relationship with angels, you can live with a more angelic consciousness. There are many, many ways to evolve spiritually, but you become something. You become a spiritual person who has spiritual qualities, very beautiful spiritual qualities. You can have qualities of spiritual beauty or qualities of spiritual power. Do they really finally take you completely beyond yourself? That is the question. And as far as I can see, in Sufism, there are different schools of Sufism, some which will be more spiritually inclined, some which will be more mystically inclined, some in which you develop these spiritual abilities, spiritual qualities, spiritual light, or for example, do spiritual healing work. And others, for example, the Naqshbandi path to which I belong, in which you could say are more mystically inclined. And our sheikh said, there is nothing but nothingness, because that is the emptiness into which the mystic is drawn. They call the dark light of the Deus absconditus, because even God is not present there in any form, in any image, in any way you can imagine. And it is the dazzling darkness of the mystic, which is slightly different to spiritual consciousness. You know, if you are embraced, you embrace mystical consciousness, if you embark on a mystical journey, you are no longer the master of yourself. You surrender, you are taken beyond yourself. And then finally you could say you merge into the will of God, whatever the will of God is, because we think of God as a being in the sky or an all-powerful omniscient, which he or she is, but really God is much more beyond that. The Sufi says he's beyond even our idea of the beyond. So what happens to you then belongs to the tradition, belongs to the will of your teacher, and in the Sufi tradition one is always in service, but the quality of that service can be very different for each person, for each individual. Some people are drawn back into this world, some people work in the inner worlds in silence and prayer. So it is very, very individual. You can't generalize. To die before you die, that is very simple, that is to get rid of the ego while you are still in this world. This is the process of fana, of annihilation, to die before you die. They say, nothing is possible in love without death, because real love takes you beyond yourself. And so a lot of the classical images of Sufism are about dying, there is sweet death and there is violent death. One can drown sweetly in honey, in the sweetness of God, in which you lose yourself in this incredible sweetness, where you want nothing for yourself, where you cease to exist because there is only the sweetness and the overwhelming presence of God. But there is also a very painful death, and so It is like the sheikh is sometimes referred to as the executioner, as the one who puts the wayfarer to death. Because this really has to do with letting go of the ego, letting go of the mind, letting go of all of your identities, everything you think you are, everything has to go. Because there is another reality which is all around us, which is waiting for us. But we have to leave ourselves behind in order to step into it. How painful is the process? It is so unbelievably painful, you don't talk about it. It is indecent to talk about how painful it is, because yes, it would put anybody off. Nobody would want to go there. It is so painful. It is, Al-Halaj says, it is painful beyond the limits of created nature, beyond anything that can ever happen to you in creation. Why? Because it is your very heartstrings that are cut. You know, I've been fortunate, I've never experienced intense physical pain, but there comes a place in physical pain where you go unconscious, where the spirit separates from the body, where you can't cope with the consciousness anymore. And in spiritual pain, that doesn't happen. The pain can get more and more and more intense. And so it is the most painful thing you can ever, ever imagine. But those are just words. It is the blood in the heart, the blood that is spilt, that is really the mark of the real Sufi, one might say. But then, maybe there are great beings who just surrender, who just say, beloved, do with me what thou willst, and then there is no need to be torn apart by the sword of love. One can hope, but for most of us, there is pain. It is not an addictive pain, it is a purifying pain. It is not a self-pitying pain. It is pure, pure pain of the heart. There is this saying, heaven and earth cannot contain me, but the heart of my devoted servant can. Which means the heart has the capacity to contain the whole universe. It is an extraordinary organ of spiritual consciousness. But, and here is the but, there is also a hadith, I am with those whose hearts are broken for my sake. And so the heart has to be broken. And to break the heart, it is, people have a glimpse of it in a human love affair. They say their heart is broken. That is, can be upsetting, but really it is nothing to what happens when it is broken spiritually, when this whole fabric is destroyed for his sake. Seer, the secret of the universe. Yes, yes, the Sufis talk about the secret of the universe, seer. One understanding is that seer is a substance given through transmission, through this succession of saints we were talking about earlier. And it is a substance that the human being needs to evolve beyond the world of duality, to be taken into the secret of life, which is its oneness. That on its own, the human being cannot make that primary shift in consciousness from duality, from the sense of its own self, from the sense of its own mind, into this deeper reality of oneness. And so to help the human being make this transition, this substance, the most precious substance in creation, seer, is given, that allows the human consciousness to change exponentially. And the Sufis say that substance is given through the grace of the teacher, through the... And that is why, for example, in India, and our particular Naqshbandi path came from India, there is this differentiation between a guru and a satguru. A guru is somebody who can teach you, who can give you practices. A satguru is somebody who has access to this divine substance, who when the disciple, when the wayfarer is ready, can give it into their spiritual centers to help them to make this shift in evolution. And without it, there can be no real shift. Seer is a secret. It is a secret. It is a Sufi secret. It doesn't contain anything. It is. It is a substance. It is just a very, very, very special substance. It is a bit like liquid gold, but that it's not a physical substance, it's a spiritual substance, and it enables the human being to make this shift in consciousness from ego consciousness to divine consciousness. Again, you talk about the outer as if the outer and the inner are different. For divine consciousness, there is no difference. In fact, the Sufis talk about the secret of the word kun, to be, which is the divine secret of creation. And at the beginning of the journey, yes, you go within yourself, and there is a difference between the outer world and the inner world. And often, traditionally, you turn away from the outer world, from all of the desires, all of the attractions, the illusions of the outer world, one would say. And you are given practices to help you to do this, like the zikr, like practices of remembrance, like practices of meditation, or to learn to be alone with yourself. Solitude in the crowd, being alone with yourself, even if you are surrounded by other people. And in that state, you are still living in the world of duality, the inner and the outer, you and God, you and another. But when you step into the world of divine oneness, all that disappears, and you begin to see, for example, the beautiful interplay of inner and outer, how it is all one, how the light in the inner world is reflected into the outer, and how this world is a manifestation of God. In fact, one of the primary experiences of a state of consciousness is what the Sufis call, wheresoever you turn, there is the face of God. You see this world not as separate objects, but as a manifestation of divine presence. And the Sufi says, actually, he is unknowable in his essence, but you come to know him through his creation. So you see his face in everything. You come to know him in both his beauty and his terror, because mystics are realists. We don't have paint a picture of God, of the aspects of God we like. We honor both the darkness and the light, because he is unknowable. We cannot judge him, we cannot put him into our small human frame. He is beyond, he is tremendous, he is terrible as something of which we must be afraid, and also so beautiful and so tender. But in those states, in the boundaries between inner and outer dissolve, it is one of the confusing aspects of mystical consciousness, because you begin to exist in a very, very different world in which the boundaries that you knew before have gone. And yes, there is still inner worlds of meditation, and there is still the outer world of waking consciousness, but they are no longer as separate as they were before. Because of course, the awakening into oneness is just the first step on the journey, on the real spiritual journey. And there are times when this world becomes just a very, very thin veil, and there are other worlds you see through this world. Again, it doesn't make sense, is there a place for inner mystical truth in today's world? Because inner mystical truth is. It is probably today's world that is not. La ilaha illallah, there is no God but God. And inner mystical truth is truth. Today's world is 90% or 99% or 99.9% complete illusion, because, as I say, it is built upon a state of consciousness that imagines we are separate. And so, for the mystic, it is not a question that makes any sense, because you aspire to live in truth. Yes, there can be some constrictions, because everybody around you is apparently living in a world of duality. Of course, they are not. There is no such thing as a world of duality. There is just an illusory consciousness that creates images of duality. And so the mystic is really the living close to the foundation of life. And in a way, life belongs to the mystic. Everybody else is boxed and imprisoned and just looking at images on the prison wall. In fact, Shamsi Tabrizi, he says, why do you live in such a dingy prison, you know, when there is this beautiful garden out there waiting to be explored? So the sad thing is that in today's world, people do not really live in the mystical sense, in the true sense, in the sense of the sacred. And as a result, people's souls are deeply unhappy. As a result, there is this primal anxiety in the culture, because people sense they have a primal wisdom in them, that they are living in a world that doesn't actually exist, that is getting in a way more and more bizarre every moment. And so there is this anxiety that they are missing the boat, that they are not where they ought to be, but because the West, as I say, made this choice and banished spiritual mystical consciousness a long time ago, there is very little way to get back. Yes, in the last 20, 30 years, there have been these Eastern traditions that have come to the West, but often they have got caught up in this whole Western idea of individuality and the focus on the individual self, and lost part of their power, part of their integrity that sees the individual self exists, yes, but it is just part of a bigger self. It is just one note in an orchestra. What is the most important contribution Sufism can make? You know, really, I don't know. I really don't know. I have thought about this a lot. And yes, I could say that Sufis hold the secret of oneness. They believe in the oneness of God. They believe in the oneness of creation. They believe that we are all part of one great being, or some Sufis would say a reflection of one great being. And that in this time of divisiveness, of insularity, in some cases almost reversal to tribalism in some places, parts of the world, that to have a consciousness of oneness, a vision of oneness, an understanding of oneness that embraces all human beings, but also all of creation, because oneness, is an important contribution. And you could also say that because Sufis at their core hold this tradition of the awliyâ, of the masters of love, or the friends of God, and that there is a need in humanity to know that we are supported by such great spiritual beings, that we can be directed by such great spiritual beings, that we can be helped not to fall into the abyss into which we are rushing by spiritual beings who understand the very fabric of life and the very essence of what it really means to be alive and what it really means to be a human being. And that this holding this tradition, they hold it not for themselves but for the world, because even if nobody else knows, if it is held in consciousness in this world, it is present. It is one of the simple spiritual truths. If you don't have to tell anybody what you know, if you just hold it in your consciousness, it is known in this world. And of course, you know, Sufis, we hold the mysteries of divine love. Maybe that is the simplest, maybe that is the most potent, that there is this substance in life called love. And it is the greatest power in the universe, and it can move mountains, and it can move hearts. And mostly it is veiled from humanity. But we are the guardians of the secrets of love. And maybe just to hold that consciousness, that power, that knowing of love. It's like this Beatles song, "All You Need Is Love." It is so true. It is simple truth. They say mystics teach simple things, and those simple things change people's lives. And just to hold in our hearts, in our consciousness, this knowing of this great power of love. Because most people are too busy, they're too involved in their job, in their family, in themselves, to step outside of the circle of themselves, and the Sufi would say, step into the circle of love. And if we can hold that love for the world, maybe if it is his will, because for the mystic, for the Sufi, everything is according to his will. Maybe through that something can be given to help humanity at this time of crisis. But these are just ideas, these are just images, because really, as a mystic, we bow down before God. And it is all His will. It is. It's said in the Lord's Prayer, may thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And the Sufi maybe is a place where His will can be done on earth. I don't know.